Today, it's the cancer that claims one victim every hour.
He called me to tell me the diagnosis, and he was crying. When your doctor's crying on the phone, it's a pretty good indication that this is serious.
We'll tell you what this killer is and how you can protect yourself from it. That's next on Canadian Edition. Well, hello and welcome to Canadian Edition. I'm David Gartson. So glad you could join us for today's program. As we're moving toward Easter here in March, we're just thinking about the tremendous promises that are ours in the gospel of Jesus Christ, that because Jesus came and lived among us, and because he was willing to die on the cross, we have promises that God has fulfilled. Some of those promises go back hundreds and thousands of years as Jesus was prophesied about. And when Jesus came, he fulfilled those promises. Now, we've been looking at something that is part of my background. When I grew up in Timmins with Jim and Marion Poynter, every dinner hour before we could leave the table, we had to draw something out of the precious promises box, a scripture verse that we would somehow take a hold of. And here's the scripture verse for you and me for today's program. It's from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Here's the promise. He who comes to God must believe that God is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. The key here is this idea of faith. The precious promise is this, is that if we seriously seek God, and if we believe that he will reward us because we are determined to seek him, then he will meet us, and he'll meet us at our point of need. Where are you today? Do you have a point of need at this point in your life as we're moving through March, as Easter is coming, and you're needing God to intervene in a special way for you? We want you to know that if you'll diligently seek him, that you'll be rewarded by him. And part of that diligence in seeking is prayer, and we have prayer warriors standing by. The Bible says if two or three of you will agree together, then God will hear and answer. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. We have some prayer warriors who believe that as we seek God diligently, he answers our prayers. And so we challenge you to appropriate that promise throughout this day and into the week to come. Well, melanoma is the deadliest type of skin cancer. It's the second most common type of cancer among teens and young adults. And as Lori Johnson tells us, it's on the rise.
She was our princess. She was our baby girl.
Jamie Regan was an all-American girl looking forward to a promising future, but melanoma took that all away.
She died 3 weeks before her 30th birthday.
During her short time on Earth, Jamie touched many lives.
Jamie was beautiful. She was vibrant. She was a bundle of energy, always had a smile on her face.
Jamie's loved ones are not alone in their grief. Melanoma kills one American every hour, and the numbers are rising. The main culprit is ultraviolet radiation from the sun or man-made. Your risk increases if you're fair-skinned, blue or green-eyed, have had 5 sunburns or 1 blistering sunburn. Tanning beds increase your risk a whopping 75%.
Jamie's bad habit was using tanning beds. She would go to the tanning bed every day for lunch, 7 days a week, and do a 20-minute tan.
Her doctors believe, Jamie believed, that it was from her use of the tanning beds.
Melanoma begins as a mole on the skin. Then as it grows, it moves deeper where it can hijack your lymphatic vessels, travel through your body, and attack major organs. The key is catching it early and removing the problem before it reaches the lymph nodes. That can put your survival rate at 99%. It goes down quickly from there, 65% if the cancer reaches regional lymph nodes, and 16% if it makes it to distant lymph nodes or organs. Jamie didn't know any of that. In fact, she visited the doctor for an unrelated issue when she mentioned a mole on her back would sometimes itch or bleed.
He called me to tell me the diagnosis, and he was crying. When your doctor's crying on the phone, it's a pretty good indication that this is serious. I'd never heard of melanoma before.
It's very painful for Jamie's mother to relive her daughter's death, but she tells the story in hopes of saving someone else's life. She likely already succeeded. In fact, she may have saved my life.
She inspired me to get checked out by a dermatologist who removed a suspicious mole, biopsied it, and later informed me it was melanoma. So I went back so a surgeon could remove much of the tissue surrounding it.
Got some moles to look at?
Dr. David Pariser, president of the American Academy of Dermatology, says people should get a full body exam every year by their primary care physician or dermatologist. Then every month, people should do their own self-exams.
Early detection is actually the key, because if we could find every melanoma early, we could cure every melanoma. And what people need to do is everybody needs to be aware of their moles.
And get to the doctor immediately if a mole resembles any of the ABCDEs of skin cancer. Moles that are asymmetrical, borders are uneven, color varies within the mole, diameter is larger than a pencil eraser, or they evolve or change in any way.
Melanoma can develop anywhere on the body, even in hidden places, like between the toes, under the fingernails, or on the scalp.
Ask your hairstylist to look carefully for moles when you visit the salon. Some hairstylists do it automatically and may have saved their clients' lives.
When I started coming to Patricia said, you know, you've got something there. It needs to be looked at. And so I did. I took her advice and went to the doctor, and sure enough, it was something he thought that needed to be removed.
In the 34 years Patricia Ingmeyer Richard has been doing hair, she's found cancer on 7 clients.
Now, maybe there's been another 100 that I've suggested go to the doctor. There wasn't anything. But my concern is I'd rather send 1,000 people to the doctor than miss one case of cancer.
So although melanoma deaths are on the rise, we can slow that trend by finding and eradicating problem moles early. And if you want that sun-kissed glow, try a spray-on tan or use self-tanning lotions. They're safe. But avoid too much sun and wear sunscreen applied generously and often. Finally, whatever you do, stay out of tanning beds.
People always ask me, you know, how many times, if I just go a little to the tanning bed, is that okay? And my answer to them is, I can't tell you how many cigarettes you can smoke before you get lung cancer. And I can't tell you how many times you can go to the tanning bed before you get skin cancer. But what I can tell you is that it's all cumulative. And that every time you get a sunburn, every time you get cosmetic tanning, it just adds a little bit more. And the clock is ticking. And at some point, the bomb goes off.
Lori Johnson, CBN News.
You know, one of the most challenging requests that come into our prayer warriors and our prayer lines are people who have just recently been diagnosed with cancer. Whenever you hear that word, it just sends such fear into our spirits, doesn't it? But we believe that greater is He that is in you, that is Jesus Christ, than he that is in the world, and that fear is not from God. And so if for some reason this day, you've been somehow faced with I just had a sense in my spirit that there are some watching today that just in the last few days, you've heard that awful word that you have cancer. We want you to know that you don't have to face that alone. We're here to pray with you. If you'll call us at 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700, if you'll come in confidence to God, He'll walk with you through the valley of the shadow of death. That's what cancer is. It immediately casts over us a shadow of the valley of death. But the promise is that God walks with us, that Jesus will walk beside us. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. Let us walk with you in that valley of hope this day so that you know Jesus is there beside you. Well, still ahead, a young pastor and the secret that was going to cost him his job.
On the surface, everything seemed to be perfect. But what people didn't know is what was going on behind closed doors.
Find out what he was hiding when we return.
Morning. Sorry, guys. I must have slept through the alarm.
Don't worry. Frank seems to have run out of gas again.
You must have had some weekend.
Oh, you wouldn't believe it if I told you.
Try me.
Well, my wife and I help counsel couples with marital problems.
You're kidding, right?
Oh, I barely got my grass cut this weekend.
Well, we help deliver food and blankets to inner-city families.
I guess he had time to feed the hungry in third-world countries, too.
Huh? Yeah, we help.
How'd you manage that?
And we joined the 700 Club. They do those kinds of things all the time.
What did that set you back?
Would you pay for that cup of coffee?
You'll be amazed by what you can do as a member of the 700 Club. Your gift of just 65 cents a day, $20 a month, will help reach the lost for Christ in powerful ways. Call now and join friends who are restoring broken lives with God's love, providing food and clothing to the needy in your community, preaching the gospel to the unreached, and opening churches where there are none. Join the 700 Club and change the world with the change in your pocket.
At just 22 years of age, Brian McKnight was a successful pastor, husband, and a father. But it was ambition that eventually cost him everything.
As a young pastor, I had a beautiful wife, incredible children, had a wonderful church. And on the surface, everything seemed to be perfect. But what people didn't know is what was going on behind closed doors.
Brian McKnight was only 22 when he became the senior pastor of Canaan Baptist Church in Pine Bluff, Arkansas.
It's very intimidating being young, but it was a good church and we had a vibrant ministry there.
With Brian's career off to a good start, this should have been a happy time for him, his wife Teresa, and their two children. But the reality was that his marriage was slowly falling apart.
We argued all the time. If you walked by our house in any given evening, you may hear screaming and fighting, and you may even hear a dish break from time to time. She always felt like I gave more time to other people in the church than to her.
One night while they were arguing, Teresa confessed that she had an affair several years before.
I realized that in our marriage, everything pointed back to that moment, that hidden sin, that bondage that was on her life poured over into both of our lives.
Despite their problems, Brian and Teresa were determined not to become another divorce statistic. But as the church started demanding even more of Brian's time, once again, he had trouble finding balance.
The church was growing faster than ever before. We started building a new building, hired new staff, and a lot of different dynamics came in there that created even more stress in our marriage that I wasn't prepared to deal with as a young father and a young husband.
In desperation, Brian resigned as pastor of Canaan Baptist and made plans to relocate his family to a church in Denver.
That I thought making a move geographically and having all of our surroundings change would benefit not only my life, but our marriage.
But just a few days before their big move, Brian and Teresa had a bitter fight.
I looked her right in the eyes and told her I wanted a divorce. I didn't think about what my kids would go through. I didn't think about what she would go through. I didn't want anything else but out of that marriage. And 13 years, and I had more than I could take.
After several months of separation, Brian and Teresa divorced. Teresa and the kids went to live with her family in Kentucky. Brian remained in Arkansas, overwhelmed with shame. He did stay in close contact with his children.
I felt like such a failure. I had failed as a father, a husband, I failed as a pastor. I failed in every area of my life. And I was lost. I felt like God could never use me again.
Brian's lifestyle changed dramatically. He moved into a trailer with a woman he had known for only a few months. Then one afternoon, Brian had a revelation.
And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit just came down on me, and I realized how far I was from God. I dropped the cigarette in the dirt, I dropped my beer, and I told my girlfriend, we have got to turn this around. And she immediately felt that same presence of the Holy Spirit that I did. And we got down on our knees and prayed, asked God to forgive us.
In the weeks that followed, Brian and Dana married and started attending church. Brian got a job at a uniform company, and in 2002, he and Dana had a son they named Brandon.
And then one day, out of the blue, I walked into my office, only to find out that I lost my job that day. So any stability that I had in my life was gone again.
Almost immediately, Brian sank into a deep depression.
It wasn't just the stress of not being able to pay the bills. I think it was just the lack of worth. I just didn't feel like I was worth anything to anybody.
Then a pastor from Brian's past invited him to a men's Bible study. During the class, Brian talked openly about his struggle for the first time. The other men prayed for Brian, reached in their pockets, and gave him all the money they had.
And these men loved me at my most broken time in my life. And the Holy Spirit said, if these guys can love you where you are now, how much more can God love you? And the light went on.
1 year later, Brian moved his family to Nashville, where he worked for a Christian radio station. But it wasn't long before his friends and wife started encouraging him to go back to being a pastor.
At that point, I began to consider it for the first time since I left the ministry that maybe God did want to use me in that place again.
In October 2008, Brian established the Summit Church in Knoxville, Tennessee. Today, that church is expanding, and Brian's passion for the ministry is stronger than ever.
Through a long, hard road, I discovered that God's forgiveness is far-reaching and it's unconditional. I also discovered that my value was never in what I became by myself, but it was what I became in Jesus. 10 years later, I still have guilt because for my children who had to live through a broken home. But today I'm happier than I've ever been. I have a beautiful wife. We have a wonderful son from this marriage. And somehow we figured out how to live life to the fullest. God is a God that doesn't keep a list of your sins, and he's got a better tomorrow for you.
A lot of times we minister to people who have experienced a phenomenal and profound failure in their lives. They call in and they don't know where else to turn. That's one of the privileges we have of being here. Accessible to you through those prayer lines, those numbers that you see on the screen. And we hear all kinds of people and all kinds of needs. But some of the saddest are those who have been broken down by life. They have failed. They have fallen. They don't know that they can ever get up. And one of the things that we hear pretty systematically from folk is that they want to blame everything else. They want to blame all of those things outside of them, circumstances or other people or situations, and they're not willing to take on the responsibility for the fact that the real cause for their ultimate failure, their utter failure, is not that which was outside of them, but that which was inside of them, in terms of the fact that they have unresolved, unreconciled relationships with God through Jesus Christ. The bottom line is that sin will destroy your life. And while we live in a sinful world and we live in a fallen world and all of those factors can impinge on us, yes, people treat us badly and circumstances seem to conspire against us and we seem to be at the wrong place at the wrong time. But fundamentally, our ability to navigate those particular challenges depends not so much on what's outside, but what's inside. And right now, I could well be talking to some folks who, for the first time, you've realized that the problem is not out there with somebody else. It's in here. It's in your heart. That you have unresolved, unreconciled sin in your life. That you have an account that needs to be paid with God. And you don't know what to do, do you? You don't know how to pay that account. You don't have anything with which to pay it. The good news is there's someone who's willing to pay it for you. And his name is Jesus Christ. He came as God's beloved Son because he loves you. He knew you couldn't pay the price to reconcile you to God. And he came, died on Calvary, gave himself, so that through his sacrifice, you could be forgiven and you could be reconciled to your Heavenly Father. Do you know him today? Have you come to grips with the fact that the problem is in here, not out there? And that the answer to in here is to have your heart transformed by the love of God in Jesus Christ. All you have to do is to reach out to him and say, Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. Forgive me. Are you willing to do that? Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, I just ask that you would enable people by the power of your Spirit to admit that they're sinners and by faith to embrace Jesus Christ as the answer. And as they do that, may the power of the Spirit seal them for eternity. If you've been willing to do that, we would love to hear from you. 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700. We have some wonderful teaching materials called A New Day. A new day because you've been transformed on the inside to face the challenges of the outside. Give us a call. Well, up next, a newborn's life is on the line, and his parents must make a crucial choice.
Scott and I were sitting in this little conference room with all these doctors and the chaplain who were telling us that we needed to make this decision pretty quickly. And it was either the bypass or the heart transplant.
See what this couple decided when we come back. From the moment Patrick Shugart entered the world, his young life was in jeopardy, and his parents were faced with a crucial decision. But they didn't have to face it alone. Just watch.
When he came out, I remember I saw him, and then he turned blue. Like, from the minute they cut the cord, the nurse noticed it first, and he was having trouble breathing.
Maureen Shugart had worried about her unborn baby for 9 months. She was 38 years old, pregnant, and sick all the time. Doctors tried to assure Maureen and her husband Scott that all was well. But when Patrick entered the world on May 25, 2004, he was struggling to breathe. He was quickly transported to nearby Children's Hospital in Omaha.
The cardiologist, said that, it was really, at that point, they really could not give him any more medication without becoming toxic to him, lethal. So if he got any worse at all, there was nothing they could do for him.
Patrick had a rare case of myocarditis, an inflammation of the heart muscle.
Scott and I were sitting in this little conference room with all these doctors and the chaplain who were telling us that we needed to make this decision pretty quickly. And it was either the bypass or the heart transplant. Scott and I just knew without even speaking, he spoke to our hearts and said, if you leave this with me, then it'll be all right. And so that's what we basically did. We said we're going to give it up to God.
The Shugarts denied the heart transplant, telling doctors they were waiting on God. That night, Maureen called the 700 Club prayer line.
I watch the 700 Club a lot, and I have seen so many miracles on that show. And it just occurred to me that I should call them. So I called and they prayed with me. About a day or so later, a doctor showed up with this research medication. And he said, I heard about your baby.
Dr. Romero at Creighton University was conducting a blind study with an experimental drug, and Patrick fit the requirements to participate. Patrick wasn't guaranteed he'd receive the drug and not a placebo. But to the Shugarts, the possibility was a ray of hope.
He got the first dose that night. And within a day or so, he started making a reversal. Even the doctors were shocked. He, within a week, was off all the medications. And that is really sort of unheard of. They woke him up, and here was this strong, screaming baby, who's really fighting to live. And so I was so happy that God had answered my prayers.
Patrick remained in the NICU for 3 weeks. At his six-month checkup, there were no signs of the illness that nearly took his life. Today, he is a happy, healthy, and very active six-year-old boy.
I love God because he saved you when you're sick.
Just to, see him, and when you think back of everything we went through, to really remember where he was, how near death he was, and what a miracle he is.
He's proof that you can stare death in the face, and the message of the cross, that God can conquer everything, even death itself.
One of the things that the CBA ministries are built upon, and George Woodward joins me now, is this whole idea of prayer. We believe that prayer works. And this precious promise today, George, I've just been soaking in, that if we diligently seek Him, that He rewards that. That diligence to come and to pray in faith, believing.
Yeah.
Talk to me a bit about prayer in your own life.
Well, you know, what I've discovered is that God is looking for a relationship with us. Right. And so it's not just me coming with a list for Him.
Right.
But if I can have a relationship with Him, He knows everything I need. He's there. But when I verbalize those things, when I bring them to Him in a relationship kind of atmosphere, there's something dynamic that happens. God intervenes and changes things miraculously. It's wonderful.
Well, George, we have so many people who call our prayer lines and who pray with us and expect us to pray for them. And as president of our ministry here in Canada, I'm going to ask you to pray in faith believing. Let's come boldly to the throne of grace and believe that God is going to speak. Please lead us in prayer.
You know, as I was looking over the prayer requests that were just here with us just today, there are some things that are very, very ominous in people's lives. But I believe God is changing circumstances in people's lives.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I thank You, Father. You said, come boldly. So we come boldly to You today, recognizing that You are the healer. You're the deliverer. You're the one that changes circumstances. Father, You're the one that turns things right side up. So, Lord, we look to You today. We thank You, Father, that You're the healer of our physical bodies. You're the healer of our emotional lives. Father, You're the one that changes circumstances in our life, as whether it might be job-related or finances or relationships or whatever it is. Father, I thank You that we can trust You. We can put our full confidence in You because You said You love us with an everlasting love. So, Father, I thank You for hope today that's rising in those that are listening. I thank You, Father, for the glory of God to surround them. And, Father, that they will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that You have not left them, that they're not there on their own, but You're there to meet their needs. Thank You for changing circumstances in people's lives today. Father, we come into agreement with Your word that says by the stripes of Jesus Christ that we are healed and whole and healthy. I thank You, Father, for transformation in relationships, bringing even those lost children back again. Father, I believe there's so many that their hearts are yearning for their families to know You or recommit themselves to You again. Father, I thank You that You are married to the backslider, You said. And so, Father, we can trust You with them. We thank You for all these things today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, George. Amen. Wow. Praying with authority. I mean, that's the key, ladies and gentlemen. We have confidence. This is what the Scripture promises, this promise we're holding on today, that we come and we believe and we trust God, that He responds to us. And we want you to be able to pray with authority as well. And we have a little teaching booklet on the power of prayer. If you'll call us at 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700, we'll get that right out to you. And also, if you're on our mailing list, you're beginning to receive some information about our week of prayer coming up toward the end of April. And we want you to respond to that. Please get your prayer requests back into us. You know, as we think about Easter, what a time to be praying, what a time to be believing God. And so we want you to know this day that we believe in the power of prayer, and we would love to pray with you. So give us a call. God bless. We'll see you next time on Canadian Edition.
For more information, or if you'd like to help continue the ministry of Canadian Edition, please write to us with your gift today. Our address is CBA, Post Office Box 700, Scarborough, Ontario, M1S4T4. Become a 700 Club partner and write today.